Does everybody have a packet in front of them?
Really,
yeah, okay. I think we're gonna get started. We might be expecting a couple more people who are finding their way here because it's the first day. But welcome to Entry to Entrepreneurship. I'm Alice Maggio. I'm the Executive Director of Berkshires, and I'm the Director of Programs at the Schumacher Center for New Economics. And Berkshires is the sponsor of this program, and as you'll see in your packet, it's also been supported by a lot of organizations and businesses in our community, as well as individuals. So we're gonna start off with some introductions so everybody can get a sense of who's in the room, and then we're gonna look at this packet, which you all have gotten a chance to look at, and then we're gonna kind of start our real lesson. But I'll just start, and then we'll go around the room so we can hear where we're all from. So I thought we would just start with kind of the basics. We'll look at the packet I gave you. Everybody has the same thing. And we'll get familiar with what this class is all about and what are the expectations. And then we can go into the fun stuff, which is actually the content for today, which is going to be an introduction to our local economy and thinking about what are some gaps in our local economy. Then we're going to have a special guest who's not here yet, Maddie Elling, and she's going to talk about her own business, which is a great example of a local business. So you can kind of be inspired by that. But at the end, we'll talk about what's expected for next week. So let's look at the packet. So everybody has the same thing. The part that's bound is what we'll start with. You can see all of the partners for this program, as well as our sponsors. Those are the people that make this possible. So thanks to all of our sponsors, some of whom are in the room. Maddie, how are you?
Good.
How are you? Good. So here's Maddie. She's our guest. Let's look at the first page. You'll find the calendar and the names of all of the classes. So this class is kind of special because we have a different guest presenter pretty much every week. You'll see some people twice, you'll see me a lot, you'll see Rachel every week, you'll see our mentors every week, but we also will have guest presenters pretty much every week. So that's one of the things that makes this program special. The main idea of this program is for you to write a business plan by the end of this, which is very ambitious because business plans are not simple things, and it's not usually something you can do over the course of 12 weeks, but we're gonna try, we'll do our best. And this is kind of a way that you can get an introduction to that process. So let's turn to this where there's homework. So that's for you to fill in yourself. So every week we'll talk about what's expected for the next week, but you can keep track of it there. This is the important page I want to look at, page 5. So the final product of this class is for you to write a simple business plan. We have a couple of deadlines along the way, but the final event, the kind of culmination of this whole program, is where all of you guys are going to be presenting what you've done, your work, to the public. And that might sound scary right now, but we'll prepare you for it. And it turns out to be pretty fun. We present at Dewey Hall in Sheffield, which is a community hall. And you can invite your parents, you can invite your friends. And it's a way for the whole community to see what we're doing here. And we'll get you ready for that. So if that sounds scary right now, it's okay. And we'll make sure it might still be scary when you're up there, but you'll get a lot of support and we'll make sure you're ready for it. So I wanna point out that attendance is really important in this program for multiple reasons. So one is that it's really quick. So we have to do all of this in 10 weeks of class, and that final week is actually our presentations. So being here for every class is pretty important because if you miss a class, you'll miss a lot. And then the other reason is that look at all of these community members who have joined us, and think about all the people who are coming in here to present, and think about how they're volunteering their time to be here for you guys. So you want to respect that by showing up and respecting their time. So attendance is really important. If you have any questions or problems, always call me. You can call me on the phone. That's the best way. Emailing me works too. But please keep in touch with me, and I'm gonna be keeping in touch with you the whole time too. So you've probably already gotten some emails from me, but please check your emails, and please make sure that my emails don't go to junk or anything like that. So you'll see that there's going to be your presentations on April 12th. So I hope you'll all put in that date and let your friends and family know about that. That'll be in the evening instead of 3:15. All of our other classes are 3:15. We have two breaks. So there are 10 sessions, but there are 2 weeks where we have breaks. So it kind of spans 12 weeks altogether. So you'll see on February 22nd, we won't have class. And on March 15th, we won't have class. But all of that's written down, and please make note of that. So overall, what you're going to be doing in this class is learning about business skills. A lot of us in school, we don't learn much about business. So this is a chance to learn from people who have businesses, some business skills, and start to think in a slightly different way. Rather than academic all the time, we'll be thinking in a business sense, and that's kind of different. You'll get to write a business plan, and then you'll also get to make connections with people in our community. So that's a really big part of this program too, because you're gonna meet all these people who are coming into class, all of our mentors who are in the room, and that means that they're gonna know you, and you're gonna know them. So if you go on and you wanna start something, or you wanna continue to work on your business plan, you're gonna have all of these people who you can reach out to, and they're already gonna know your faces. So it makes it that much easier. So I want to encourage you all to think about our community members here as resources, and they're all here because they wanna help you out. So don't hesitate to call them or email them. And that's what all this is. Meet the team section is all of these people have said, I want to help. So that's huge. That means they do want to help. They didn't just say that for kicks. So that means you can contact them and ask them questions. If that's a specific question or something bigger, doesn't matter. Okay, so a couple more things before we get on to the fun stuff. At the final event, if you finish this class, if you attend all the classes and you present your plan at the end, you are going to be awarded 200 Berkshires. So I don't know how many, could you raise your hand if you've heard of Berkshires before? So who wants to volunteer what Berkshires are? Who wants to say what Berkshires are? Just doesn't have to be right, can just take a stab at it. Anybody? Charlie?
It's like money that's like a currency within the local community, and I think it's a little bit less than the worth of a normal dollar. Is it like 95 cents or something?
Well, 95 cents will actually buy you a Berkshire.
Oh.
So it's almost a little bit more. It depends on how you use it. If you buy a Berkshire at the bank, it costs you 95 cents. You can spend it as if it was a dollar. So that's right. It's local money. And so you're going to be awarded 200 Berkshires at the end of this program when you finish, so that you can think of that as seed money. You can use it to start your business or as a part of starting your business, or you can use it to go spend it in the local economy. So that's pretty cool because you don't often get paid to write a business plan. But that's kind of what you're doing. The other thing to note is that if you don't want to use your, so let's say you're 15 and you're in high school and you write a business plan in this program, you might not be ready to start that business when you finish, right? Because you might have a lot more things to do, like finish high school, go to college. So if you feel like this was a great experience, but you're not going to use your business plan, we would really love it if you could donate it to our library of good business ideas for the Berkshires. So we have a lot of the plans that have come from the past years of classes. We have them up on our website so other people could use them as inspiration if they'd like. So at the end of the program, we really love it if you say, hey, yeah, you can put that up, you can share that. But if you want to keep it to yourself, you can. So just, you'll have to let me know at the end, okay? And you can see other plans that have come out of this program and other ideas that have been generated by the community at that berkshires.org/business-ideas. Okay, so that's kind of all the business. So now, all of you at the beginning of your packet, you have a whole bunch of business ideas. Oh, no, wait, sorry. You have sample business plans. Okay. So those are things that I'd like you to look at over the course of the next week or just keep referring to, because those are kind of the best example of what has come out of this class so far. Okay. So they're nicely formatted. They have a lot of good information. So that's kind of, if you're wondering what it looks like when you're finished with this program, those are good examples of what you'll end up with. Each of those could probably use a lot more work to actually go and start a business, but that's a pretty good result for the end of this program, just to give you an idea. The other thing on the back of your packet, you'll find something that looks like this. So that is a packet of ideas that have been generated by our community. So these are business ideas that have come from people who live here, and they have worked. We've done a whole series of workshops this fall to generate this packet. So this represents, I think, 7 community workshops where people who've lived here, who grew up here, who work here, get together and think about what are some things in our community that could be here but aren't. And then they actually talk about what would that actually look like? What is the competition? What's the market? What would it cost to start that up? So these are like little snapshots of business ideas. And you could take one of these and you say, oh, I really like this idea. I want to see how this could be fleshed out further. And you could take it and run with it for this class, okay? But you also don't have to. You can come up with your own idea. But this is just for your reference. So if you are looking for a business idea, you can look in that packet. Okay. Are there any questions so far for me? Okay. So the last part of this thing that's actually bound into your binder is the business plan worksheet. And this is for you to take notes on, for you to do whatever you want with, but it's something that we've developed with the Massachusetts Small Business Development Center in Pittsfield. And they are, you're gonna hear a lot from Keith Girard, who is the director there, but they're a resource center for people who have businesses or who wanna start businesses so that they can work on their business plan and do better in business. So we've worked with them to create this worksheet, which is a simple outline of a business plan. It looks pretty much like a normal business plan would, and it has some kind of instructions about how to, what goes in each of these sections. So you'll use this as the outline for your final business plan. You're gonna wanna type your final business plan, but this is where you can take notes and kind of jot things down. Okay, so that's this packet. Am I forgetting anything important? Okay. So Rachel graduated from this program, so she knows it inside and out. All right. Do we have any questions or concerns or worries or anything? Okay. If you do, you can always raise your hand or get my attention if I'm just going on and on. Okay. So, one of the things that makes this class special is all of this community input. So we call it a crowdsourced business planning program because some of the ideas have come from our community with like that packet. The sponsorship for this program has come from the community. We have all of our community members pitching in to help out our students. So it's kind of a different model. It's something, it takes a lot of like organizing, right, to bring all these people here, but it has a certain amount of power because of that. So we're calling that crowdsourced business planning program. And the other thing that sets this program apart, I think, from, I mean, it just makes it different from your normal business planning program, is that we're trying to inspire business plans that could take place here in the Berkshires. And so we're hoping that you'll think about this as an environment for businesses to grow. And we're not strict about it. If you have an idea that doesn't apply here, you can go with that. But we kind of strongly encourage thinking about this as a special, an environment where you might set your business as the market and the place where you'd take off. So that's one of the things. So just to get us thinking about that, I have a presentation for you. So every week we're gonna have a presenter, somebody coming in to talk to us. So there's gonna be kind of content for the first half of the class. This is kind of a general rule, it's not always the rule. There's gonna be content, so like a normal class. And then the second part, we're gonna try to reserve that so that you can work on your own project. so that you can talk to mentors one-on-one, so you can ask questions and kind of work on your own business plan. So that's kind of, it's going to be in a way a service learning project or a hands-on project. So there's going to be work to do at home, but we hope you'll get some chance to work in class too. And that means that you have to keep me in line so that we have that time at the end of the class to work on that. But it kind of means that you can benefit from all these resources and talk to each other too. So we're going to start in a graveyard, which is a kind of strange place to start. But this is a story that Jane Jacobs used in a book about economics called Cities and the Wealth of Nations. And it's going to just, I'm going to have you tell me what it means, but I'll read you this story. So this is a Henry Grady speaking about a funeral in Pickens County, Georgia in the 1880s. So he says, "The grave was dug through solid marble, but the marble headstone came from Vermont. It was in a pine wilderness, but the pine coffin came from Cincinnati. An iron mountain overshadowed it, but the coffin nails and the screws and the shovel came from Pittsburgh. With hardwood and metal abounding, the corpse was hauled on a wagon from South Bend, Indiana. A hickory grove grew nearby, but the pick and shovel handles came from New York. The cotton shirt on the dead man came from Cincinnati, the coat and breeches from Chicago, the shoes from Boston, the folded hands were encased in white gloves from New York. That county, so rich in undeveloped resources, furnished nothing for the funeral except the corpse and the hole in the ground, and would probably have imported both of those if it could have done so. As the poor fellow was lowered to his rest on coffin bands made from Lowell, he carried nothing into the next world as a reminder of his home, save the halted blood in his veins, the chilled marrow in his bones, and the echo of the dull clods that fell on his coffin lid." So that's a kind of meant to be humorous, but darkly humorous, perhaps. Does anybody want to kind of volunteer to tell me what the author's intention was there in that little story? So Sam talked about how the community wasn't really furnishing anything for this funeral. And it's maybe that's sad emotionally, like the author kind of brings that down to saying that, you know, nothing reminded him of his home except the clods of earth on his coffin. But on a not emotional level, let's maybe talk about the economy. What does that mean? What does this story kind of talk about? John, okay, so the production of all those different pieces was outsourced. So what does that mean for the people? Sam kind of hinted at it, but what does that mean to the people of that region? Hank? Okay, so there are unmet needs and unmet opportunities in that. So that's Pickens County, Georgia in the 1880s. That's probably a rural place. And all these places that the author mentions is Pittsburgh, South Bend, Indiana, New York, Cincinnati, Boston. Those are all cities, right? So maybe all of the production, all of the factories and everything that was making something went to the cities. So if that happened, what happened to the people? Maybe the people left Pickens County, Georgia as well. Does anybody see any parallels to anything more local and more kind of current? Do you see this story? Can you talk about how this might connect to something more current, maybe happening nowadays? Kind of some of the parallels we didn't necessarily mention that from this story to the Berkshires are that in this story, it's a rural place in Georgia that is rich in undeveloped resources. I would say the Berkshires are a rural place. We have a lot of resources here. We can think more about that later. So how could we kind of harness those to meet some needs? And it might be meeting needs elsewhere, or it might be meeting needs here too. But I think it's important to start thinking about the flow of money. Where does the money come from? Where does it go? And let's say, so this guy, whoever's paying for his funeral, where was all the money that they were spending on all these things going? To all of these cities, right? Eventually. Maybe they bought them from the local hardware store. But the hardware store had to buy them from, let's see, the nails came from Pittsburgh. So the hardware store had to buy the nails from Pittsburgh. So that means the money really went to Pittsburgh. So if you try to start to think about that, that's going to help you in the next part of our lesson. All right, so, I mean, this was in 1880s, right? But really now, if you think about the picture, what would be happening? In this, if we kind of set this funeral nowadays, and you thought about where the nails were being made, where the coffins were being made, where anything, the gloves, the clothes, where would all that be made? Charlie?
Like a foreign country where it's really cheap labor. Where
right.
It's like most beneficial, like price-wise.
So someplace far away. So we live in a very globalized economy now. And I don't know, Rachel and I, Maddie, we probably all grew up with Time for Kids, where, I don't know, it's like Time magazine for kids. And everything in it was always about globalization in the 1990s. I don't know what it's like for people who are younger than me, but I think when in the 90s, globalization was kind of new, or at least it was being recognized and talked about more and more. And now we might just like take it for granted, except that we have a new president who talks about making things in the United States a lot. So it's kind of back in the news again. So I wanted to just maybe quickly, if everybody could pick an item of clothing that they're wearing, and we'll see where it comes from. Because it'll just be an exercise in seeing where the things that we use every day come from. So you can pick anything you're wearing or use and see where it's made, and then just we'll report back quickly. So I wanted to just think about, now Richard said that there might be like, there some people might call globalization, it might be a pejorative word, right? It might not be a good thing in some people's minds. Some people might think it's a great thing, but I just want to talk about, let's just think about the implications. Doesn't have to be that it's good or bad, but let's just be aware of the implications. So does anybody want to kind of think about what it means for something to be made, if we're here wearing our shirt or our jacket that comes from halfway across the world, does anybody want to just talk about what that might mean? Like, what are the implications of that? So it's kind of going where it is cheapest to produce that thing, right? Now, why is it cheaper to produce across the world? Okay, so there's kind of like incentive structures here where it might be that the company is going to make money by going elsewhere, but the people who are actually doing the work on the ground aren't making very much money. So that's something interesting you might not notice, right? You might not know about how the company pays their workers if it's a big multinational company. What else? Do you guys have anything to add? This group hasn't added very much. You can have different opinions. You can have good things or bad things or indifferent things. Right. So the point I wanted to make includes all of this. I mean, I think there's probably a lot more. Does anybody have anything else you wanted to add?
Way easier and cheaper.
Yeah. So there's the people side of the equation. There's the price side of the equation. There's the environmental side. Charlie?
Well, I feel like one thing kind of has to do with the other thing, because if you get rid of the jobs and you send them elsewhere to another country, like Mexico, like the middle class workers will lose their job. And they won't be able to afford stuff, despite it being cheaper. But if the prices go up, but then they get employed, then they might be able to afford the price of the lettuce going up a little bit because they have that better job.
Right.
Because they're bringing the jobs back.
So there are implications here, too. There are implications to what has happened abroad, right? Because there might be less strict environmental regulations abroad. There might be less strict labor regulations abroad. But then there are implications in the United States. Or let's think about just the Berkshires too, because sometimes those factory jobs are the ones that pay middle class wages, and that's something that we've seen go away a lot, like in the Rust Belt, where there were lots of middle class jobs. What about if you are kind of buying everything from elsewhere, and wherever you're buying it from, there's a big problem, right? Then you can't buy what you need anymore. That's a really interesting point. Anything else? Howard?
Going back even to the 1780s, we were growing cotton here in the United States, shipping it to England to weave it, to make fabric. And Alexander Hamilton wanted to create the manufacturing here in the United States, and he started getting people to make and weave fabric here so we could go from an agrarian economy to an industrial economy.
So that's kind of the question of value adding. Has anybody heard of value adding before? What does value adding mean? Whitney?
I wasn't raising my hand to
Oh, okay. Okay. Does anybody have any, like, John?
I mean, that's like changing grapes into wine. Or like jams from foods, I guess.
So what happens to the price there? Why is it called value adding? Yeah, so if you just sold grapes, you could only sell them for a couple bucks. But if you sell a bottle of wine, you've put a lot more work into it, and you've changed it into something else that can sell for $50 a bottle, maybe. So you're adding value to that product. So that's kind of, that's something we're going to see in a little while.
Does that connect to inflation?
How does that connect to inflation?
Yeah.
The value adding, I don't think does. I think that's a separate issue. Inflation is a whole different question, I think. Yeah, it might be a whole other course that I might not be prepared to answer. Kind of to wrap that whole discussion up, okay? This is pretty dramatic. But this is a factory collapse in Bangladesh that happened in 2013. So this is like the most extreme example I could give you, but I think my main question is, what happens when something that you're buying, you go down to the store, you go to the outlets, you buy something, what happens when it's made really far away from you? And I just would like to say, like, my question would be, do you know how it's made? Do you know who's making it, how the company treats the environment, how the company treats the people, or is there something disastrous on the other end that you don't know about? So I don't know if anybody, this is something that actually happened in a clothing factory, and it made the news, so a lot of us heard about it, and it actually changed, I think, the supply chain dramatically for companies, I think, like Gap and H&M. This was a big wake-up call because people who bought the clothes saw it on the news and said, I don't want my clothes being made in a factory that collapses and kills people. So the companies that were buying from factories like this started to work with the factories to make them safer, and that actually made a big difference. Are there other examples of kind of what, I don't know, what can happen? I guess we might have already talked about it. Like, what can happen on the other end? Sam gave a good example of wages, Anna was talking about environmental protection, but there could also be actual, you know, physical questions about what's happening on the other end. So I guess what I'm saying is, if you were to have a factory in your own town and it collapsed, you wouldn't know about it, right? But if it's on the other side of the world, you might not know about it. Okay, so I want to just, so right now we kind of think in terms of the global economy. We think of the economy as globalized. I want to just kind of make an experiment and think about how we might zoom in and think about regional economies. So we also kind of organize things often in our economy by nation state. So there are trade laws, there are trade agreements between nations, right? But I don't know, did it really make sense the way that the United States border was created? Is that really an economic construction, or was that something that happened for political reasons or other things or social reasons? Does that really make sense as a way to organize our economy? So I want to ask that question and then try to think about how we might think of a regional economy. So this is the Berkshires, right? Let's think about what our economic resources are here. And what defines the Berkshires? Even if you don't think about geography, I mean the, I just gave it away, about the economy, but what defines the Berkshires? How would you think about the Berkshires if you were describing it to somebody? You guys are not from the Berkshires. Do you want to say how you describe the Berkshires? Anybody who's not from the Berkshires?
It's very green.
Very green. Why is it green?
It's full of forests.
Forests. What else? How would you describe it? Oscar?
It's a county in western.
It's a county, so there are political boundaries around it, right? But if you drive to New York City, or if you drive south to Connecticut, people there sometimes still call this part here or here. They might call that the Berkshires too, and that's outside the borders. So why is that? Why do they still call it the Berkshires?
Yeah.
We might not approve of it, but okay, the mountains. So there's kind of a geographic identity, right? That there's a mountain range that goes through here that has a certain look and feel to it.
Well, it's just the lifestyle. Like, it's more like laid back, like farmhouse, like work on the farm, while in the city it's more like your stereotype, like I don't know, like Wall Street, like businessman who's constantly working. It's more laid back.
So there's a lifestyle that defines the Berkshires, and also there's the rural nature of it. So you're not in a big city. There's not density of population. So all of these things kind of play into the identity of the Berkshires. What about the economic resources? Or what are the resources of our region? We already mentioned forests, so we could think of that as a resource. John? Natural resources that kind of become economic resources because of the beauty, right? Tourism. And then what about those people who are here? They have money that they've earned in the city. They also have maybe education. They have a lot of know-how. So that, you could think about that as a human resource. John?
Yeah, I thought the second home owners was an interesting idea, because that's definitely our economy is based a lot towards. We are appealing to second home owners. Mm-hmm. When you said that, like, I'll come off my head, that's kind of why it is the way it is.
Mm-hmm. So that's a resource. What about other natural resources or human resources that we have here? Hank?
Retired people or people have their own money and they spend it, that's it.
Yeah, so people who are spending their money.
Yeah, they have other, maybe Social Security, and maybe they have some money in the bank, and they spend it on the local economy.
Sam, did you have an idea?
We have a strong culture in the music and arts.
Okay, cultural activities, cultural know-how. Charlie?
Well, it's like when people like retire from like New York or something, they come to live here, and they might not have a job, but they're helping our economy because they're literally just buying all the stuff in our economy, like their homes and all the material to like make their homes. A lot of it comes locally.
Right.
So
What about natural resources? So timber, logs.
Farming and growing.
We have grass. We have soil.
We have
a river that's polluted, but. Yes. we have rivers and streams. We have
animals.
Water power, potentially. We have what?
Animals.
So we have grass, we have sunlight. Those are resources. Anything else? I would like to mention also we have Berkshire Community College, we have high schools.
Education.
Keely.
Like sports and fitness, community centers and stuff like that.
Community centers, fitness. Yes.
Good school system.
Good school system.
We have Boston and New York City right here. It's community resource.
Right, so a big city is only 2.5 hours away. That's good. Okay, so that's good. Good brainstorming. Because look, why is it keep advancing? You guys didn't tell me. Okay. So now I want to introduce you to Jane Jacobs. I mentioned her at the very beginning. So Jane Jacobs was a kind of self-taught economist who studied history, She wrote books about economics, even though she never studied to be an economist, because she was observing the way that the economy worked. So she had the idea that import replacement was the engine for economic development. So she thought of it as the kind of way that cities could keep their economies going and strong. And import replacement, she thought of as a way of looking at what you were importing and deciding to make it yourself. So we've talked about this a lot, but if somebody could just sum up what that means in terms of money flow. So if you've been importing something and you decide to stop importing it and start making it, what does that money flow look like?
Sure. People start buying from you and then you start using your capital.
Right. So let's say we're in the Berkshires, and we've been importing all this stuff, right? And the money has been going out. Just like in Pickens County, Georgia, they're sending all their money away. So everything you import, you have to send money away for. But let's say we start making it instead with, let's say, factories or something. And that means that instead of sending that money away, the money is going to that factory, the company that's making things here, and it's more like a circle here, like Sam said. So it becomes, instead of sending money out, you keep the money in the Berkshires. So that was her idea for how a city, she talked about the import replacement as an engine for economic development. So the city can be stronger and wealthier, or a region can be stronger and wealthier if it starts to replace imports with local production. And this connects to something that Schumacher, E.F. Schumacher said, and he is, I work at the Schumacher Center for New Economics, because we have all of his books and papers. We're called the Schumacher Center. He was an economist, a German economist who worked mostly in England, and he wrote Small is Beautiful in the 70s. So he looked at the economy. He was a traditional economist who went to Southeast Asia and actually changed his whole way of thinking about economies. And his thought was that production from local resources for local needs is the most rational way of economic life. And dependence on imports from afar and the consequent need to produce for export is highly uneconomic. So he was basically saying it makes more sense to make things locally to meet local needs as much as you can. You're never going to do that 100%, but it just makes more sense to do that as much as you can. And then only import things from other places as little as possible when you need to. And this, the part unknown and distant peoples was really important to him because he thought that it was important to know who's making things and how they're being made, because you could then kind of check in on it and know what it was like and if you approved of it morally and if you would be willing to pay for that kind of product. So this is kind of what we're asking you to consider as you think about business opportunities. But first, I just want to go quickly because I want to make sure there's time for Maddie. Why does it matter? Okay, so we've talked a little bit about it. We've talked a lot about it, actually. But why does it matter to make things locally if you can, as much as possible? Why does it matter to keep money in your community, like we just talked about, as much as possible? Well, for one thing, you're keeping wealth in your own community. We're just going to be thinking about this as from the perspective of the Berkshires, okay? But you could go and think about your hometown and think of it the same way. So this is what it looks like if you spend your money in an independent business. This is in, this is a retailer store compared to a chain retailer. So this is what happens to your money. If you spend a dollar in an independent, then 48% of it stays in your local economy. So it's going to stay in your region. That's going to be profit and labor because the business is locally owned. So the person who owns it lives in your town or in your region. And any profits are going to stay there. Labor is going to be hired locally. So any kind of wages are going to go to local people. Local businesses are more likely to buy for procurement for internal use. So they're going to buy things for their own place from other local businesses. They're going to buy things for their store to sell from other local businesses, 14 cents. And then they're also going to give to charities. They're going to donate to local nonprofits and charities. So 48 cents on the dollar is going to stay in your own area, supporting people, schools, infrastructure, tax base, If you spend that same dollar in a chain retailer, 13.6% of it is going to stay in your local community. So the rest of it is going away. So we don't really know where it's going. Depends on the company. So if you spent it with Walmart, then the profits are going to go to the Walton family and the shareholders. And the retail, you know, all of the products that they buy are whatever companies from around the world that they buy from to stock their shelves. And only this much stays in your local community. So that's probably the people working on the floor, right? Another reason that it can make a difference to spend your money locally or keep your money locally is that you will be higher, you'll be able to support more jobs in your community. So if you have more successful businesses because people are spending their money locally, you'll have successful businesses able to hire people locally. If you spend your money with local businesses that are making things, businesses that are factories creating new products, that means that you're supporting innovation and expertise in your own community. So that means maybe a company that's making something in your own community can hire people straight out of the high school, or out of technical school, or out of a community college. So, and then those people who get hired are gonna learn skills, they're gonna be able to be part of jobs that might be more middle class, like Charlie was talking about, that pay well. And so you're gonna keep that kind of expertise there. Or we also have a history of manufacturing in this country. So if you can support, if there are local companies happening in your community, and though you can keep your wealth and keep your spending there, you're maybe going to be supporting the repurposing of existing buildings. So maybe an old paper factory, this is a paper factory in Lee, that has been there for a long time, but now they're making high-tech papers. And they're still employing people. They've kind of changed what they make slightly, but they're still using those buildings and still employing people. And it all kind of adds up to a more diverse community that can support lots of different lifestyles, lots of different jobs, hire people from all different walks of life for all different kind of things, and then have them hopefully able to buy things and support themselves and have a livelihood. So it kind of adds up to something. And I think the diversity part of it is really important. Just like Megan mentioned, you don't want to be dependent on one industry. You don't want to be doing, in the Berkshires, all we did was make paper. And then computers came along and nobody used paper anymore. They just used their iPhones. Well, then your whole economy would be gone because you just depended on paper. And so we don't want to be just dependent on one thing. It's good to have diversity. Okay, so now these are just some examples because I want to get onto the real example. This is what would it look like if we did change the way we buy and produce things? If we started to think about regional economies, regional scale production. So this is kind of what it looks like now. We chop down trees and we send them to Canada or to China to get processed into lumber, then we buy it back and build our houses with it. That's kind of a crazy cycle, right? Because it's a lot of trucking. We didn't even talk about that, about all the transportation. But instead, we might make something that's a little more local scale, something smaller scale. So this is a sawmill that can go around from tree lot to tree lot and saw logs into planks. So it doesn't look like probably those trees are going to really big sawmills, but if you were gonna produce lumber locally, it might look different, it might look smaller. You could then make things out of that wood that could be sold locally. Here's another product that you could buy from a big company that makes it all over the country in big plants, or you could buy your beer from a local brewery, which has a local family that owns it, and the beer's fresher because it doesn't have to travel very far. You could also think about other products that are food-based. So this is a value-added product, cheese, that comes from goat's milk, right? If you sold the goat's milk by itself, you probably couldn't make as much as if you turn it into cheese and sell it. But what about cleaning products? They're kind of, so these are just examples of all different aspects of how you could take local needs and then see how you might meet them with local production. And this is a, I like this picture because it shows the full cycle of, like Sam was mentioning, something that's kind of cycling rather than just a supply chain. Maybe it's more like a supply loop. So you go from the grass to the sheep, to the fiber processing, to the designers and makers who turn it into clothes, and then those clothes can become compost to go back on the grass to feed the sheep, to get the wool. So that's kind of a, that would be an ideal world, right? But I just like to look at that as a kind of, maybe that's what we're going for. So anyway, those are some examples, but I'm gonna rely on you guys to come up with a lot more examples and use your knowledge of living here, growing up here, talking to people, talking to your parents, talking to your friends, to think about what are the things you use every day, what are some maybe some opportunities. They don't have to be things you use every day. They might be special things too. But I'm gonna turn it over to Maddie, and she's gonna tell you about her business. But this is a great example of a business that is value adding, making something right here in the Berkshires.
Yeah. Hi everyone, I'm Maddie. I am from the Berkshires, born and raised here in West Stockbridge, and I co-own Hosta Hill. We are a vegetable ferment, sauerkraut, and kimchi business based in the Berkshires in West Stockbridge. So we started our business, it's me and my partner Abe who own the business together. We started in 2011, the spring of 2011. We were very small. And at the time, we were working with a cheesemaker here in Great Barrington, making Berkshire blue cheese. And we started attending the market and selling that cheese at the market. And each week we went, we were like, we could have so much more on our table. Like, what else could we be bringing? And at the time, we were making sauerkraut and pickles and brewing beer and making bread. And we were really into fermented foods. So looking around, we thought, okay, what can we bring to the market? And we spotted a business opportunity. So value-added farm goods, that word comes up again. You know, we can grow all sorts of crops here. What can we can and put in a jar? We don't actually can our products. We age our products, so they're naturally acidified, so we pack them in the jars. They're a raw, live food. And you can taste them later today. So yeah, looking around at the market, no one was doing sauerkraut or kimchi, no value-added products, locally produced fermented products, quality and delicious pickled products. And you know, so on top of wanting to bring a cultured food to the market, we also wanted to start a business of our own. We wanted to work for ourselves. We wanted to get involved in the food scene and yeah, working outdoors as well. So we were excited to start bringing, we started bringing two varieties. So yeah, started with one farmer's market. We now have our full product line, but we first started with our sauerkraut and our crimson kraut. And we were also making another product called tempeh, which is a cultured bean product that we no longer do. And so we started bringing these products to the market. They were really well received. It was really great to start at a farmer's market, low inputs, minimal permitting. To go to a farmer's market to bring a product to a market, food product, you need to get your serve safe, which is like a day-long certification, and you learn all about food safety and making products that don't, you know, make people sick. And then you need to be operating out of a commercial kitchen, which is like a church. They're usually certified commercial kitchens or restaurants. So we were processing out of various kitchens in the area, and it was fine and great for about 2 years. And then into our third year, we really needed to just have a kitchen of our own. So we decided to do a Kickstarter. Kickstarter is a crowdsourcing platform like Indiegogo and GoFundMe. And we raised 14 grand from our community to build a kitchen in the basement of the house that we live in. And we were successful. The Kickstarter was a great way to get our business out there. People learned about us, people got excited about us. This was a video that people could watch. And so that was really fun, and it kind of like, it really did like kickstart things. So that was our third year, and at that time, we were at a handful of farmers markets, just selling mainly at markets. And we kind of had to step back and say, is this what we want to be doing? Like, we started this business on a whim. It was this fun little like cottage industry business, and now here we are. We have a business, people really like our products, like, okay. So we hadn't written a business plan from the start. We had just started it day to day. We were very in the moment, and it was all great and fun. So we took a step back, and we actually worked with Keith at the SBM, the Small Business Network in Pittsfield, and he was like, you need to write a business plan. So we did. And yeah, the business plan was just a great way to like focus and vision and just keep our goals kind of in view and just making sure we were working towards those goals. So we made a business plan, we got clear on what we wanted to do, we built the kitchen, and along with building that kitchen, we also decided to get our wholesale license, which would allow us to sell to stores, restaurants, cafes. And that is a whole nother set of licensing, not crazy, totally doable. So that allowed us to, yeah, that's when we started selling to restaurants and cafes and stores. And farmers markets are great, but they're seasonal. So we really wanted to start doing this full time. At the time, we had a few other jobs. We were like patching it all together and making it work. We said, okay, we're gonna put all our time into this, all of our time, all of our resources and savings. Also, side note, you know, we raised the money to build the kitchen. We also put all of our savings into this. We borrowed money from family. We did not take out any serious loans. So we've been able to avoid serious debt, which has been also really nice. And again, this is one way to start a business. There are many other ways. You can take out loans, which are great. This is one example. Besides making our products, we also love to grow vegetables. And this is another big part of our business. So we're striving to grow the majority of the ingredients that go into our products. So sauerkraut is like fermented cabbage. Kimchi is kind of a Korean style version of that. The crops are cabbages, carrots, radishes, onions, garlic, ginger, hot peppers. So yeah, we get to grow them as well. You know, it is challenging, but and we do a lot, but we're getting to a point where we can hire in more help and get efficient. Along with efficiency, last year we got some grant money to buy equipment for the farm. So this is a tow-behind transplanter, which allows two people to sit on it, and someone can drive the tractor, and you put the plants in these little tubes that fall into the ground. So that was a really fun tool that we got to use this past year. So our goals, again, having a business plan, it helps you stay on task. Like, why am I starting this business? What do I really want to offer to my community? Like, what do I want to get out of this? So for us, you know, it was supporting ourselves, like working for ourselves and actually being profitable. We also want to support our employees. We want to make it a fun workplace, pay well. We want to support sustainable and local agriculture. We care about the environment. And we can grow all these amazing crops here. So whether we grow them ourselves or support other farmers, that's a win-win. We want to support our community. We love doing things like this. This is an awesome program. I also love teaching fermentation courses in the area, and I helped head up the Berkshire Ferment Fest, which was second annual this past summer, and we'll do another one this next summer. And yeah, mostly enjoy your day-to-day activities. You know, work becomes not so fun, work can be not fun, but my goal, and it's a work in progress, is that I want to have a fulfilling life. I want to be doing what I truly want to be doing. That's where I feel like I shine the most, and I can also give the most to my community when you kind of stick to what you really want to be doing. So while, again, it's not like cut and dry and perfect, and there's going to be challenges that you have to face, but yeah, just keeping in mind, like, what are we really doing all this for? Like, why did we start this from the beginning? So it's fun to think about all that. So 2016 was a big year. These are some kind of notables. We purchased a garlic peeler. So we process a lot of garlic. It goes into our kimchi and our other products. So we got this cylindrical piece of equipment where you just put in a bunch of garlic that you've broken up, and you run water through it, peels it. It saves us like days of work. And that is something, actually, this piece of equipment, I know a lot of restaurants buy in pre-peeled garlic, and that's coming probably from California. And yeah, maybe during the growing season they buy local garlic, but I think the majority of the year they're like, it's just easier and it's even probably a little cheaper to buy it peeled. So we're kind of trying to say, like, we can pre-peel garlic, like lots of it. We also have like hundreds of pounds of garlic still right now that we like buy garlic from us. That could be something.
A new income stream.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. Yep. We purchased our tow-behind transplanter, Abe converted that tractor you saw in that picture was actually an electric tractor. It's a really simple cultivation tractor, lightweight, and we were able, he converted it. So it's like a golf cart. We charge it up after every time we use it, and we do still use a larger tractor that we borrow from our neighbor farmer, Anna, who works for them. So, you know, we're not like just using electric. In the perfect world we would, but we still are using gasoline. We got some great features in the Boston Globe and Sierra Magazine for our products, which is really exciting. We helped head up the second annual Berkshire Ferment Fest. We processed near 50,000 pounds of vegetables this year. Those were all local vegetables, the majority of them. We only grew about 25% of them. We had a rough year with the drought, but in turn we were able to source from all the farms in the Pioneer Valley and the Berkshires and Hudson Valley, so we were able to support all of them. And we got 4 grants through MDAR, Held Grinspoon, Berkshire Ag Ventures, and PERC for our farming and business ventures. So there are so many resources in this area. SBN has been a great resource, the Small Business Network up in Pittsfield, Keith, who you all will meet. But aside from that, there's grants out there for farming and for small business, and overall, we just feel really well supported in the Berkshires with business owners who are always happy to help. There's Berkshire Grown, the local food advocacy group. So it was a challenging year. It was a successful year. We sell at a handful of farmers markets, but the majority of our distribution is to stores. In the Berkshires, we're very well distributed in the Berkshires between stores, restaurants, cafes, and we also sell in the Pioneer Valley, Boston area, Brattleboro area, and then New York City. And the Boston area and New York are places we're really trying to expand into. So this year we're focusing on expanding into greater areas surrounding the Berkshires. And aside from that, we sell farm stands and CSAs as well. So we're really going for it with wholesale. We find that that's like a good way to keep the income flowing and to keep us growing. And it's great, fermented foods, it's definitely growing. It's a growing food trend. And Whole Foods named cultured foods, fermented foods, a top trend of 2017. So we're feeling pretty good about that. Looking forward to 2017, we'll be farming again on the same fields as we did the past 2 years. We're going to grow some ginger and turmeric in a greenhouse to add into our products. That's one thing that we haven't been buying locally. You can grow it in greenhouses, so we're excited to be doing that. We're applying for a large grant to set up an irrigation system, to set up watering, because I foresee some extreme weather patterns in the future. We are going to be moving into a large kitchen, so we've grown out of the kitchen we're currently in. We're pretty much at capacity. So the goal is by this summer, end of summer 2017, to move into a facility in Pittsfield. We have something somewhat lined up. We have another business who's buying a building, and we are essentially going to rent space from them. It's a huge building right across from GE, actually, in the Industrial Turnpike area. So that's going to be a big growth spurt that allows to really get some larger accounts and to produce as much as we want. So we're gonna have a big growth spurt this year and putting things in line for that. And that's kind of it. Alice, I don't know if if there's any questions from you or from people.
Could you mention that business plan that you laid out at the beginning?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it today like a real living kind of thing where you're always looking at it,
it is.
Always making mid-course corrections based on, could you talk about that?
Sure, that's
for
a really good
bit?
Point. Yeah, so we did the business plan a few years ago via Keith, and I think when we did it then, that was like, okay, what are our goals and what's our vision for this business? And the past year, we've been using it and tweaking it more and adding to it for grants, especially to show people who might lend us loans. And so basically right now I'm fine tuning it for this big move that we're doing to, we are gonna be taking out a large loan. And so now the business plan is speaking to, how are we gonna make this move? What is our market? What are the trends and like who are our customers and what are the logistics of the move, X, Y, and Z? So yeah, definitely this past year more than ever.
So without a business plan, you never could have gotten to where you are today?
I don't think so. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's so it's a living document.
It is. Mm-hmm. Why don't we just keep all of our business in the Berkshires?
Yeah.
Because then we aren't growing and making what we want to be making ultimately.
Oh, what do you mean it's limited here in the Berkshires?
It is limited here in the Berkshires, right? Yes.
How many people do you think buy kimchi in the Berkshires? Or how many people would buy kimchi at the beginning, and how many people buy it now? Like, just give, because Richard's point is that there aren't enough people to buy your products to support your business right now. I mean, we have 130,000.
Well, it could have been.
There's 130,000 people.
It could have been.
Well, I feel like
just made it a sort of back pocket operation.
I could have made it a back, yeah, and I, you know, if I have kids or if I'm trying to do something else, I feel like, and paying rent realistically in the Berkshires, stuff is so expensive.
Right.
I'd have to have four other jobs, which is kind
of. So you needed to expand your market in order to achieve your goals.
Yep. Yep, we do.
Oh,
and
what a great idea.
But we're not going to sell to China or California. Yeah. Well, our goal is to definitely stay regional and not, you know, not go all across the country.
And by the way, are you employing more people now than you did 3 years ago?
Yes.
How many more?
How many more? Just two.
Okay.
We're still very small, yeah.
But you wouldn't have been employing those people if you just kept it small, right?
Probably. We would have been driving ourselves crazy, though. I would not want to be doing all that processing of the cabbage myself for all these past
five. So not only did you create a business that achieved all your goals, you're also employing others. And you will continue to as it gets bigger.
As it gets bigger and as we expand out of the Berkshires.
Right.
I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
Do you have your own distribution company, or do you, how do you get into supermarkets and other?
Good question. Distribution. So we do the majority of our own distribution ourselves. We drive it around the Berkshires and out to the Pioneer Valley. We work with two small distributors. Marty's Local is one who's here in the Berkshires. He's a new distributor. And then Myers Produce, and they really just do their distribution, and distributors work in all different ways. And the people we work with, the smaller ones, work on a case price basis as opposed to their margins, as opposed to them having their own margins. It's a little good. Anyway, so we do the majority of our own distribution, and then we have some help, basically. But again, looking into fall 2017, we're lining up a larger distributor to pick up maybe accounts at Whole Foods or more Big Y's, and because the volume of those, what we can move through them, is more than we can ever do. And then that was the thing we've had this past year grappling with. Well, do we just buy a large refrigerated van and hire a driver and just distribute all of our own stuff ourselves? And we've been grappling with that, and I think the answer is mostly like, no, we're not going to do that. But yeah.
How do you get Big Y to take your product?
Well, we are in one Big Y here in Great Barrington, and they approached us. I think someone asked for it in the store, and I've been trying to get into more Big Y's for the past 6 months, and we're definitely not at the top of their list, and they've been really busy, and I've been badgering them, like, we're still here, we're still here, we're still interested, and it's slow going, but they're trying to do more local. And so I think, you know, we go to stores, we drop off samples, we just trying to get your foot in the door, really just like putting a face to the name of the business is a big thing. But with larger stores like Big Y, it can be hard because they're, you know, they're corporate and they have a lot going on and they're working with a lot of vendors. And a big store like that, they love buying from one distributor where they can get all of their stuff, as opposed to, oh, now we have to deal with this one vendor and like an order from them, and which day is their delivery day? So the logistics of that can
be. But their customer was able to make it, like if customers in Great Barrington asked for that, they were able to make a difference to the company.
Yep.
Do you want to just...
And that wouldn't exist if Guido's didn't exist.
Yeah.
Think about what Big Y was like before Guido's came.
They're competing against each other.
Yeah, but that's also very important to understand the market.
Yeah. So I brought some jars to try. So we have our plain kraut here. This is a mix of just cabbage and sea salt. It's pickled, so it's vinegary tasting, but there's no vinegar in here. It's raw, live. They're aged like bread or beer, or it's kind of like kombucha. It's a different fungus in there that preserves it. So plain, no spice. Our crimson is a mild spice kraut with a mix of veggies. Has a little bit of spice, it's nice. And then this is our daikon kimchi. So we have four varieties of products. Sauerkraut, crimson kraut, curry kraut, and kimchi. Those are what we have all throughout the year. And then we have our seasonal specials that we do for fun, like our daikon kimchi. We have it only this time of year, because daikon is hard to grow from summer, or from like spring to summer, and very expensive. This is what we have now. This one's spicy. This one also does contain fish sauce for any vegans. It's our only non-vegan one.
Does anybody, well, do you want to taste it? Yes? I'm going to pass some around, so you can take some if you want some, okay?
Anna, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
For the purposes of this class, like, you are growing your own vegetables, you have your own kitchen, but what is there for other people to work with you? Like, what do you need? What do you have to buy in still that is an opportunity for someone else to create a business?
Good question. So, okay, we're buying all of our vegetables locally. We're packing them in glass jars that we're getting from a jar distributor in Springfield. If anyone can make jars with lids, that would be great. We're buying our labels from a printer in Eastern Mass, a local printer. I know we have local printers, but they're very small. And we're buying in large quantities, and the quality is a little different. So let's see, jars, labels, lids, various equipment that we use to process them. I guess like knives, blades. We're doing a lot of chopping. People can make, there's blacksmiths around here. People can make blades and various tools. Barrels, we're fermenting in 50 gallon barrels. And we don't usually buy those new, because we can always find them. Like, we get old olive barrels from the bakery, or there's typically vinegar stored in them. So we're going around various production facilities and seeing what we can get. So those are kind of recycled. But yeah, it's plastic, it's glass, it's metal. Maybe we'll use wood vats. There are large wooden vats that we could buy. They're just very expensive. We want to move towards stainless steel, actually, and those, are, again, are really expensive. Yeah, go ahead.
How did you make out with regulations as far as cleanliness or health and farming?
Well, so as I mentioned, selling to farmers markets is a little less stringent with rules and regulations, and they're not checking out. It's like you're dealing with your local board of health. And when you're selling to stores and restaurants, you have a little more on the line. And, you know, we have to be insured. So that means we have to, like, buy our own insurance to make sure if we were to get someone sick, we're covered up to X amount of money. And then with our commercial kitchen, we have to get it inspected by our state health inspector. So they want to see non-porous surfaces. They want to know that we've taken our allergen awareness test, which is another online test, and we're ServSafe certified. But it's mostly they want to make sure we're like using non-porous surfaces like metal, plastic. But it's not crazy. There's fees you have to pay, but that's part of doing business.
What's your name again?
Monica.
Monica.
Can you talk a little bit about competition within other businesses in Berkshire?
Yeah, good question. Competition. So we are the main fermenter in the Berkshires. And when we started this, yeah, we saw the gap, like no one's doing ferments in the Berkshires, but in the Pioneer Valley in Northampton, or they're actually in Greenfield, technically, real pickles. They are our competition, friendly competition. We know them all. That was actually one of two. Real pickles is right here. We have also Hawthorne Valley. They're not on here, actually. This is real pickles too. Hawthorne Valley's in the Hudson Valley. So we kind of feel like we're in the Berkshires. There's real pickles in the Pioneer Valley. Hawthorne Valley's in the Hudson Valley. This is Poor Devil Pepper Co. They do fermented hot sauces. We also do a hot sauce. They're also in the Hudson Valley. And we're all, I mean, we feel like the fermented food industry is just growing, and more people are finding out about it, and more people are eating it more. Doctors are recommending it. It's a trendy thing, but I think it's more than a trend, and I think it's a old food that's kind of coming back into style, and so that's exciting, and I think it's just growing, at least for now. And yeah, I'm so happy to say that, like, we're all really friendly with all these people. Like, I know these people, and these people are in Rhode Island, they make kimchi. This is the only non-local. So it's very amicable, and Real Pickles in Hawthorne Valley are way larger than us. Real Pickles has been doing it for 15 years, I think, and so they're, you know, we're kind of catching up to them, but they're doing really well, and we haven't affected their sales. And Hosta Hill, and this, they're newer, so, and it's interesting. It's like, okay, like, we came on the scene, and I'm sure, like Real Pickles was like, oh, like, here we go, like, some competition. Like, now they're on the scene, and it's interesting. Like, we want, like, I want to be friendly, and I don't want to feel scared about competition, but definitely with, like, seeing Cheat Kitchen come up more, and, like, we were at a market, or they're doing a market that we used to do in Boston, and we're like, we're not at that market anymore, like, maybe we should be there. They're like taking a but I have to, like, remember that, you know, there's the ferment pie is only growing, and, like, there's lots of slices in that pie for all the businesses to have. And so there is competition for sure, but we're all doing really well, I think. Yeah,
we have time for a couple more questions. Two more questions. How about some students that haven't asked anything yet? Has everybody gotten some of whatever they want to try? Mm-hmm. Yes? Anybody want something that they didn't get to taste?
The spicy one.
With regards to your retail prices.
Yeah.
Do you set the prices so that when your customer sells it, that's, they can't change the retail? Or, you know, do you have any rules that you set forth with your retailers?
We don't have any rules. So we have our retail price is what you see it at on sale for at the farmer's market or on the shelf. This is the retail price, $7 for a jar of sauerkraut. When we sell it to that store, we sell to them for like $4.50 a jar. So, because that's that margin there between $4.50 and $7, that's the store margin. That's what the store needs to pay their rent and employees. And we don't. We have a SRP, a suggested retail price that we, a lot of the buyers and grocers kind of definitely stick to that because they don't want to be underselling it or overselling it.
So are your competitors in the same retail prices in those places?
Give or take, yeah. Yep. And that's something, pricing structures and all of that, we've been kind of refiguring them a little bit, and we're refiguring them more for working with distributors. So like I was just saying, we sell it to a store minus like a 25 to 30% margin. And when you work with a distributor, so it's like that jar of kraut costs $7. When the distributor buys it from us, they're actually going to buy it from us from like minus like 45 to 50%. Because then they need to resell it back to that store for like, everyone needs to make money basically. And so we're making sure that we're making what we need to make to, you know, cover our overhead and everything that goes along with that. Pricing is a big thing. Yeah.
Just curious, what is the interpretation behind the design of that brand symbol?
What's an interpretation behind the logo? Yeah, good question. So Hosta Hill is what we named the product. So that's our brand, is Hosta Hill. Hosta is a plant, and it's funny because, yeah, it's a plant, and when we first started this business on a whim, like I was saying, we're living on my parents' property. We rent the house from them where we built our kitchen, and we started, and like, we need a name, and they just coined the property Hosta Hill, because we're on the top of a little hill, they have a lot of hosta plants, and so we kind of took the name and ran with it, and it stuck. And I mean, the other part of it is hostas are very vigorous plants, and I always like the idea that you can divide them up, and you can be like really hard on them, and they, like, you can throw them in the ground and they grow, and you can make more plants from them. And so I love the idea of like the diversity of that and the vigorousness of that plant. So that's, yes, it's a little like that leaf there is like a hosta leaf. And yeah, good question. Yeah.
If you could reduce the price by 20%, 30%, do you think that would improve your business and be able to sell the big wire?
I mean, we could maybe sell more, but then we would be undercutting like our competition. We would, yeah, I guess if we could, but then again, it's like, then if we want to work with a distributor, that's even a lesser price that we need to take, and we need to be making a large amount to be still making a profit. It would be tight.
And could you even make, could you even meet that demand for more if you had a demand for more right now?
Not right now.
You couldn't even make it.
We have stores approaching us, like, we can't take on any big stores right now because we have made what we've made and we're at capacity, really. So it's just now, like, I'm just working on projects to line things up financially and lining up our marketing materials and strategies to put us forward into, you know, the fall to be ready to handle all that and have standard operating procedures in place. And yeah, so staying focused and not trying to say yes to everything, basically.
Thank you, Maddie.
Yeah.
Thank you for trying it. And yeah, you can follow Hosta Hill on Instagram or Twitter or Facebook and go see them at the farmer's market.
Yeah, Gridiron Farmer's Market starts up in a few months. Berkshire Grown has a holiday market next month in February.
So I'm sure that if you stick around and have more questions for Maddie, you can try some more kraut or kimchi, and she'd be happy to help. I just wanted to talk about what we're expecting from you for next week. So at the very back part of the bound part of your packet is this worksheet. So the import replacement opportunities. So for this week, I'd like you to just go home and kind of incubate on what we've had our conversation about today. And think about import replacement opportunities. Think about potential business opportunities in the Berkshires. It could be, you don't have to really flesh it out all the way yet. It could just be like, oh, I'd really like to buy rings in the Berkshires, or t-shirts that say such and such, or whatever you kind of come across that you think you'd like to buy here that was made here. You can write that down, but I would really encourage you to talk to your family, talk to your friends, talk to your teachers, talk to your schoolmates about it. So it can almost be like a little research project, okay? So think about it as something you want to crowdsource these ideas. Ask people, hey, what is it that you run into that you'd like to buy locally that you can't? It doesn't have to be rational. It doesn't have to be something that is definitely going to work here at this point, okay? So for right now, I want you to just fill this up with ideas. But I also want you to read that packet of business ideas that came from the community. So maybe for homework, you can start by reading this packet, just reading through that, and taking a look at it, see what the ideas are, and then use this sheet to fill in other ideas, okay? And then we'll talk about those next week, but we're also going to have a guest. We're going to have Keith Girard and Nancy Shulman from the Small Business Development Center coming to talk to us next week. So if you kind of feel like there are probably lots of things that Maddie talked about today that you've never heard of, maybe you don't know what distribution is, maybe you don't know what a margin is, that's okay, because we're going to talk about that a lot more in the next couple weeks. And next week, we're going to talk about that business plan worksheet that's in here and go through the different pieces. So you'll get a kind of more concrete overview. This is like the real life example, and then we're going to kind of step back and go back to that worksheet. Are there any questions about homework or about anything else about the class? Any concerns or problems or anything? You can also always email me or call me if you have any. Okay, cool. Thank you all, and please stay around to ask Maddie questions or ask me questions if you have any.